Praise the Lord. Welcome to Lifeline Bible Ministry. God has a special blessing for you watching this video. Let's get into the message. I thank God for your life. Today we are still in the Fruit of the Spirit series. Part three today. So Fruit of the Spirit series. Once again, I just want to thank you especially for watching this video. Please, please take a moment to like this video, subscribe to our channel if you are not already in the family, and then please share this video with your loved ones. God richly bless you. Fruit of the Spirit series outline. Part one, what is the fruit of the Spirit? Part two, what are the facets of the fruit? Part three, why must the fruit of the Spirit manifest in the believer? Part four, what happens at judgment with regards to the fruit? Part five, how do we develop the fruit of the Spirit? And then we conclude this series. So this is part three. And we are looking at living in joy of the Lord. The basic outline of this part three is, the first part, we look at defining what joy is. Part two, we're going to look at defining what misery is, or what people call depression or affliction. They mean basically the same. Misery, affliction, depression, they mean about the same thing. Then, three, the joy of God in believers. Then we'll conclude this very lesson. I'm thankful the Lord is keeping you and the Lord is blessing you in all you do. Whatever is happening in your life is just by the grace of God. We always need to remember that. So let's define joy. You're going to start off with our foundational text from the book of Galatians chapter 5, verse 19 to 23. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness. Verse 20, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies. 21, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like. Of the which I tell you before, as I have also told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not, I repeat, shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Verse 22, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. So we see from verse 22, talking about the fruit of the Spirit. The fruit is one, but it has different manifestations, nine manifestations total. It manifests as love. That is what we looked at last week. Today we're looking at joy. We're going to be looking at peace. We're going to be looking at long-suffering, or what today we call patience. We're going to be looking at gentleness. We're going to be looking at goodness. We're going to be looking at faith, meekness, temperance. It's the same as self-control. Against such, there is no law. So if the Holy Spirit is in charge of somebody's life, these manifestations will be seen in a person. Okay? So believers crucify the works of the flesh, but live after the Holy Spirit. Living in the flesh disqualifies someone from the kingdom of God. If you want to practice adultery, want to practice fornication, want to practice, oh, this is just a new boyfriend or a new girlfriend, or we hanging out, or we dating. No, please. You're practicing witchcraft, you're trying to control other people. All those kind of things are works of the flesh. But the fruit of the Holy Spirit is joy. So we look at love. Today we are looking at joy. We are focusing on just joy. Okay? So joy is a fruit of the Holy Spirit. What does it mean? It is a fruit. It means when the Holy Spirit is in charge of a believer's life, the believer will have joy in their life. If the Holy Spirit is not in charge, then you see misery, you see depression, you see affliction. That means there's something else going on. It's not the Holy Spirit in charge. Because when the Holy Spirit's character is joy, the person will have joy. We need to understand that. So when somebody is constantly depressed, it means the Holy Spirit is not in charge of the person's life. How do we get out of depression? We're going to look at that today. So we have two basic questions. How is someone in constant depression led by the Holy Spirit? The answer to that is no, the person is not led by the Holy Spirit. It means there is another spirit at work. Second question, how do we offset misery in order to realize the joy of Christ? If someone has misery in their life, they have depression in their life, how do you offset those so that the joy that Jesus gives, you will be able to see the joy in your life? The answer to that is the believer enforces the mind of Christ to have the joy of Christ. If you just give in, throw in the towel, it is what it is, this is my life, and you dance around and you nurse your wounds and you tell everybody on social media, you are not really dealing with the misery. You are simply making it bigger. That's why you are out telling everybody you meet. No, if you are living in misery, you need to enforce the mind of Jesus Christ. So, joy, the definition of joy is the feeling of great pleasure and happiness. You feel happy. It's a feeling. That means it is an emotion. And that emotion comes from God. I need for you to understand that. I need for you to carefully understand what is discussed here. Emotions could come from different sources. But this very emotion we call joy of the Lord, it comes from God himself. It is Christ who gives us that joy. Just like love is given by the Holy Spirit. Misery is not coming from God. Depression is not an emotion which comes from the Spirit of God. We need to understand, not every emotion you have is godly. Some emotions are sinful. Some emotions are coming from demonic quarters. You need to understand, depression does not come from God. Affliction, misery, those type of feelings people have are not coming from the Holy Spirit. Joy comes from the Holy Spirit. So it's an emotion that the Spirit of God gives. The Spirit of God will give you that emotion that you are happy. You have great pleasure within yourself. You don't know where it's coming from because it doesn't depend on anything physical. You just experience that pleasure and happiness in you. It comes from the Spirit of God. So how could the joy of Christ be absent from the life of a believer? If the Holy Spirit is in you and he gives us love, he gives us joy, how could he be in you and giving you joy but you don't experience the joy? That's the question we have here. That simply means one thing. It means you have other things opposing the joy of Christ in you. Other things. We're talking about demonic entities. They project thoughts, and the believer simply accept these thoughts and nurse them. Now they begin to feel misery. They begin to feel afflicted. They begin to have different feelings, which is not coming from God. So as a child of God, we must have love is number one. Number two is joy. If the joy is not there, it means other forces are opposing the joy of Christ in your life. So if you are feeling down, you are feeling depressed, the first thing they go for, go see the doctor, get medication for depression, something which is caused by an evil spirit. And they begin to drug themselves. Some people drug themselves forever. They never obtain the joy and the pleasure. So great pleasure and happiness, not simply pleasure and happiness, is great. Okay? That comes from the Spirit of God. So we look at the book of 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 8 and 9. Whom having not seen, ye love, in whom, though now ye see him not, yet believing, ye rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory, receiving the end of your faith, even the salvation of your souls. What is the Bible saying here? What is the apostle saying? We have not seen Jesus, but we love Jesus. Now we don't see him. Physically, we don't see Jesus. Yet we believe in him. And we rejoice with joy unspeakable. And we are full of glory. Remember, Christ in us is the hope of glory. So when Christ, who is the very glory and the image of God, is in us, we are full of glory. We have joy unspeakable. So when Christ is in charge of someone's life, the person will experience joy unspeakable. That means great, pleasant feeling and happiness that a person will have in their life. And we receive the end of our faith. What is that? What is the end of our faith? The salvation of our souls. At the end of the day, that is the goal. But right now, as we are living, we love Jesus, we believe in Jesus, and we have joy unspeakable, and we are full of glory. The glory of God is in the believer, in the person of Jesus Christ. Look at John 15, 11. Listen to what Jesus is saying. These things have I spoken unto you, that my joy might remain in you, and that your joy might be full. What is the Bible saying here? Jesus is making a statement. He says, these things he has told us. That means the word of God gives us joy. The word of God will cause the joy of Christ to remain in us, and that our joy might be full. So we are talking about joy unspeakable. We are talking about the joy of Jesus remaining in us, and that our own joy will be full. We'll be very happy that we are saints of God. We are believers in Jesus. Faith in Christ produces unspeakable joy in life. So basically that means our faith in Christ will offset any depression. The word of God produces joy in the believer in Christ. That's what Jesus just said in John 15, 11. By the words he tells us through the word of God, we have joy, his joy remaining in us and our joy being full. Joy can be obtained by the principles in the word of God. The promises in the word, the principles in the word will produce joy in us, because by the principles in the word of God, we have the mind of Christ. And with the mind of Christ, depression has no place. Affliction has no place. Misery has no place. Look at Romans chapter 15, verse 13. Now the God of all hope fills you with all joy and peace in believing, that ye may abound in hope through the power of the Holy Ghost. Once again, what is the Bible saying here? It says, God of hope, fill you with all joy and peace in believing. So as you believe in God, if you are a believer in Christ, your faith in Christ will cause joy to fill you coming from God. So the God of hope will fill you with all joy and peace in believing. So your faith in God will produce the joy and peace we need in life. Why is God doing that? That ye may abound in hope. So we become very hopeful. When God fills us with joy and peace, we become very hopeful in God. There is nothing happening in your life that the power of God cannot solve. So we become very hopeful, and we receive this joy and peace through the power of the Holy Spirit. So it is the Holy Spirit's power that gives us joy and that gives us peace. We're talking about joy and peace from God. So if joy and peace is completely absent, you pray and you ask God for, and the God of hope will fill you with all joy and peace in believing. Romans 14, 17. For the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. What is the Bible saying here? The Bible is giving us three characteristics of the kingdom of God. The first one, okay, it says it's not about food and drink. No. Somebody say, you eat this meat. Don't eat that meat. All that is not part of God's kingdom. The Bible is very straightforward. For the kingdom of God is not meat. It's not food. It's not drink. But what is the kingdom of God about? Three things. One, righteousness. We live in holiness. Two, we have peace. We practice peace and we have peace within ourselves. And three, we have joy. And how do we have all these three? By the Holy Spirit. Once again, that is why Jesus gave the Holy Spirit to us. He giving us another comforter. Who is the Holy Spirit? Through the Holy Spirit, we practice righteousness, we practice peace, and we practice joy. If you don't have righteousness in you, you cannot practice it. If you don't have peace in you, you cannot be peaceful. You are always quarreling and fighting, because another spirit is at work. If you don't have joy in you, you cannot practice joy. People will not see that with you. You are always looking gloomy. That means there's another spirit at work in you, which is not the Holy Spirit. Christ fills believers with joy and peace so that we might have hope in his promises. The joy given by Christ is through the power of the Holy Spirit. Joy is a characteristic of the kingdom of God. So that means subjects in the kingdom of God are living in joy. Depression is not part of that. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 6. And ye became followers of us and of the Lord, having received the word in much affliction with joy of the Holy Ghost. What is the Bible saying here? The apostle is saying we have become followers of them, the apostles, and of Jesus Christ. And we have received the word in much affliction. That means we receive the gospel, the preachings, the word of God in much affliction. That means it's not coming easily. They go through a lot of trials and tribulations, even to preach. But they receive the word with joy, and that joy is coming from the Holy Spirit. So the joy of Christ comes to us through the Holy Spirit in us. we sometimes receive word in affliction. It's not easy preaching. Some people think it's easy. No, it's not. If it's easy for you, then probably you are not a preacher. When you become one, you start seeing what we're talking about here. The Holy Spirit provides joy to the believer. That's why it is the fruit of the Spirit. The Holy Spirit will give you joy. Okay, let's briefly look at misery. What is misery? And what is depression? We start with Psalm 73, verse 21. Thus my heart was grieved, and I was pricked in my veins. What is the Bible saying here? The Bible is talking about the heart grieving. That is what misery is. Misery, someone is experiencing misery or experiencing depression when their heart is grieving. So when a person's spirit is grieving, then they're experiencing misery, or they are experiencing depression, or they're experiencing affliction. Grieving means what? The heart is weeping. The heart is in deep sorrow. So when you begin to experience depression, it means there's something happening in your spirit man. Your spirit man is grieving. Grieving over what? That's the key question. What is your heart grieving over? What is your inner man grieving over? Psalm 107, verse 17. Fools, because of their transgression and because of their iniquities, are afflicted. What is the Bible saying here? A person can be afflicted because of their foolishness. And how do they manifest foolishness? They live in transgression. They live in iniquity. They practice sin. And because of that, the consequence is you become afflicted. Your heart will be grieving because your heart could lose something. Your inner man could lose something that your physical mind is not aware of. Why? Because it's happening spiritually. So the heart is aware something is lost. So you begin to feel unwell. You begin to feel afflicted. You begin to feel misery. And that fights against the joy of the Lord on the inside of you by the Holy Spirit. So when someone is living foolishly, they will do just anything and still say, oh, nobody is perfect. So they can do whatever they want. And by what they do, they become afflicted. So affliction, misery could come from our own sinful behavior. Psalm 34, verse 17 and 18. The righteous cry, and the Lord hear it, and deliver them out of their troubles. The Lord is nigh unto them that are of a broken heart, and save it such as be of a contrite spirit. What is the Bible saying here? Once again, say the righteous cry. That means we pray. We're not simply mumbling words or casually trying to pray. No, the righteous cry. The word cry means is a heartfelt, genuine, true cry. That we call upon the name of the Lord. And the Bible says, and the Lord heareth. So when we cry unto Christ, he hears our cry. It's not what they call plan B. Something is happening. My soul, my spirit, my heart is grieving. I do not know what is happening to me spiritually, but I know something is not right. And I cry unto God. The Bible says the Lord hear it, and the Lord will do something. He will deliver us out of all our troubles. We receive deliverance from the Lord when we cry unto him, not a casual prayer. We are talking about crying unto Christ. And the Lord will hear me and deliver me. Verse 18, the Lord is close to those that are of a broken heart and save such as be of a contrite spirit. The Lord delivers. Saving means he delivers you. So what is the condition for our deliverance? The condition that produces deliverance from the Lord is what? When we have a broken heart. What does a broken heart mean? It means we are not arrogant, but we have a contrite spirit. A contrite spirit means a spirit that has childlike faith and very humble. Those are the kind of hearts that the Lord is close to and the Lord delivers. So I'm having trouble, whatever is happening in my life, I cry unto the Lord out of a broken heart, out of a contrite spirit. The Lord will hear me and the Lord will deliver me. So if I don't want to live in misery, I don't want to live in affliction, it's a prayer away, a heartfelt prayer from a humble spirit. And the Lord will deliver you. Misery and depression is the grieving and affliction of the heart. Our foolishness can create affliction and depression for us. Prayer is the master key against depression. Prayer is the master key. Prayer out of a humble heart, out of a humble spirit, is the key against depression. Somebody can sing about negativities in their life all the time and nothing seems to change. Why? Because they are not bringing the issues out before the Lord. Look at Matthew 11, verse 28. This is Jesus speaking. He said, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. What? What is the Lord saying here? He says, come. Jesus is inviting you to come. Who is Jesus inviting? All that are labor and heavy laden. You carrying a very heavy load. Whatever the load may be in your life. Heavy labor and heavy load create depression in people's life. This one, you are aware of it. It is happening spiritually, it's happening physically. You are aware something is not right with your life. Something is not going well. The key point is stop the debate and come before Christ. And he will give you rest. This is the true Sabbath we're talking about. Jesus will give you rest. Stop the debate. Come. Jesus says, come. Come unto the Lord. And he will give you rest. Whatever that heavy load is, he will put that heavy load down and give you rest in life. Then you can experience his joy in your life. Most people do not come before the Lord. No. Why? They can go to church, they can do all that, but they will not come before God and bring the load before the Lord. They will not do it. But when you do it, when you cry, the Lord will save you. Your deliverance is a prayer away. Look at Psalm 40, verse 1 to 3. I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined unto me and heard my cry. He brought me up also out of an horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and set my feet upon a rock, and established my goings. And he has put a new song in my mouth, even praise unto our God. Many shall see it and fear, and shall trust in the Lord. Powerful passage. What is the Bible saying? Let's break it down from verse 1. I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined unto me. I'm waiting for the Lord patiently. And what do I do in my waiting? I cry unto him. I'm not simply idle. I'm crying unto God. So the waiting patiently for the Lord involves prayer. Waiting patiently for the Lord is not simply idleness. No, it is prayer. Prayer out of a humble heart. And what would the Lord do? The Lord would incline unto you. What does it mean? That means he will bend his ears to hear your call, to hear your prayer. The verse 2 is talking about the deliverance of the Lord. He will bring you up from any horrible pit you may have in your life. Out of the miry clay, Jesus will save you. And he will set your feet upon a rock. Rock means you cannot be moved again. And he will establish your goings. Whatever you're going through, it will become reversed. Your life will be established by the power of Jesus. We are talking about the power of Jesus to save and to deliver. The Bible says in Hebrews 7:25, he's able to save completely those who come unto God through him, complete deliverance from Jesus. Whatever the case is, not only that, he will put a new song in your mouth to sing. What does that mean? That means you're going to have a new praise. Praise. You begin to sing. You meet people, they cannot even open their mouth to sing unto Jesus. What is oppressing your spirit that you cannot sing praise? When God delivers you, spontaneously, your heart will begin to rejoice. The joy unspeakable begins to happen, and it bubbles out as praise unto God, and many will see that. Those who live close to you on your church, they will begin to see the great happiness and joy you have in your life. And they will know that it is the doing of the Lord Jesus Christ and give praise to our God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Jesus is the Messiah, the Savior, the Deliverer. Christ removes burdens and root of problems. He removes burdens. He's the burden remover. Whatever is the root of the problem, Jesus is able to save. Effective praying removes misery and depression from people. Effective praying. Whatever the issue is, when you pray effectively, we're not talking about mumblings on prayer and sleeping off. No. The first line in effective praying is out of a humble heart. Humility is an attitude towards God. We become like children. That's why Jesus said, except you become converted like little children, we cannot enter into God's kingdom. So humility is the first place we go to. For effective praying, you start with humility. You bring your issues before the Lord. If it's an evil spirit harassing your thinking, you bind that spirit, that negativity thinking will stop. So effective praying is the key against misery and depression from people. Christ delivers us and puts a new song in our mouth. That means we will sing praises unto God. It doesn't matter who is present. We break out in singing. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, Lord. James 5:13. Is any among you afflicted? Let him pray. Is any merry? Let him sing psalms. What is the Bible saying here? The Bible is giving us the prescription for affliction or against affliction. Say, is any among you who is afflicted? Let the person pray. Is any among you living in misery? Is any among you depressed? Let the person pray. Effective praying. We lay the issue before the Lord. We bind demonic influences. Some of these issues is a direct attack against your soul, against your spirit by demons. So your spirit will begin to feel grieving. So you start grieving spiritually. Even before your mind knows what is happening, your spirit is aware. So you begin to grieve. But when we pray, we bring the issue before the Lord. We don't know what it is. So you tell God you don't know what it is. But by his power, whatever is causing that grieving in your spirit must leave. You bind demon powers. Break them down. The affliction will stop. Seriously, if you pray effectively, the affliction will have no place. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 7. Casting all your care upon him, for he careth for you. We cast our care upon Jesus. We cast our care upon Jesus. If we don't cast our care upon him, but we choose to carry our own care, that heavy load will still be there. But if we cast our care upon him, he, Jesus, will give us rest. So I want to obtain the joy of the Lord. That means whatever I'm caring about, I'm bringing before the Lord in prayer. Why? Because Jesus careth for us. So to experience the joy of Christ in my life, anything competing against the joy of the Lord has to go. I'm not going to entertain that. You're not going to sit and allow any negativity to begin to happen in your life. No. Bring it before the Lord. Whatever is happening, pray. So the Bible is recommending prayer. If your prayer life is down, it is time you repair your prayer altar. Don't give in to anything the enemy is trying to do against you. Don't give in. Don't sit idle. Whatever the case is, the cure is a prayer away. Child of God, do not live like the world. And then you go about, you plaster it over social media everywhere. Your case is a prayer away. It says, is any among you afflicted? Let him pray. If you are merry, you have joy, sing psalms. Cast every care you have, whatever you care about, cast it before the Lord. Cast it upon him. Put it on Jesus. That's what the Bible is saying. Why? Because Jesus cares. He has the power to shoulder every load you have. Give it to him. Don't walk about carrying it yourself. And we are also not ignorant of the devices of the enemy. That is why we pray and bind demonic influences. 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 16. Now the Lord of peace himself give you peace always by all means. The Lord be with you all. The Lord of peace, the Lord of joy himself give you peace always by all means possible. By all means necessary, God will give you peace and give you joy. The Lord is also called the Lord of peace. Why? Jesus is the Prince of Peace. So the joy we need in life, the peace we need, comes from Jesus, not from physical things. As we pray, Jesus is able to give us the joy we need. By the power of the Spirit of God, we receive joy. Unspeakable. Prayer is the key and remedy against affliction. We're talking about effective prayer. We pray and we cry out unto God out of humility. We cry out, not a simple mumbling. Half asleep. No, we are crying out. That means seriously releasing everything unto the Lord. Binding demonic powers which might be the root of these problems. As for my church, we don't bind demons. Tell your pastor to begin to teach on that. Because some issues and problems are coming from demonic sources. Especially if these feelings and voices are coming from within you. Sometimes they come from outside. The spirits can cast spells and project thoughts coming from the outside. And people simply receive these. And these thoughts will rob you of the joy of the Lord in you. We need to be aware of this. Believers, cast our care unto the Lord Jesus. Whatever is bothering you, oh, ask for this, it is what it is. No, sir. No, sir. Ask for this, it will be this way. No, sir. That means you do not yet believe in Jesus. Genesis 18, verse 14. The Lord asked Abraham, is anything too hard for me to do? Is anything too hard? Jesus said, with men, it is impossible, but with God, all things are possible. What is the situation that you think God cannot solve? What are you dealing with, which is robbing you of the joy of the Lord? Bring the issue before God and see if the power of the Spirit of God will not melt the problem away for you. Peace and joy is given to the believer by Christ through the Holy Spirit. We receive the peace, we receive the joy we need in our life. By the power of the Holy Spirit, the enemy wants to steal your joy. They bring problems your way to occupy your mind with these problems. That a child of God, you need to relay the issue before the Lord. Cast it. Cast the problem before Christ. Cry unto him about that issue. Bind spirits behind that issue. And the issue will melt away. The issue will melt away. Okay. We're going to wrap up with a quick pop quiz. Question one, what is joy in Christ? Question two, how do believers obtain joy in Christ? Question three, why does Christ give us joy? Question four, why is prayer the key against depression and affliction? Question five, why must believers pray against affliction? I'm going to give you 2 minutes. Let's go. 2 minutes. Start. A minute more. Okay, our 2 minutes is up. Question one, what is joy in Christ? Answer, great, pleasant feeling and happiness in the heart. Question two, how do believers obtain joy in Christ? We receive joy in Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit. Question three, why does Christ, not Christy, why does Christ give us joy? So believers will have hope in the promises of God. Question four, why is prayer the key against depression and affliction? Answer, by prayer we release care unto Christ. By prayer we bind any demonic influence. And the depression and affliction will stop. Question five, why must believers pray against affliction? Answer, affliction opposes the joy of Christ. So when we pray against affliction, we begin to experience the joy of Jesus in our life. With that, we come to the end of this lesson. Once again, we thank you so much for watching this video. Please share this lesson with your friends. We shall begin part four of the series next week. God richly bless you and your family.